Hello and welcome to Harvest Church Online. We're so happy you joined us today. This is a day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Let's start our worship off with our scripture reading.
Good morning, all. Welcome to our online service, Harvest Bible Chapel. We hope you're having a lovely day and you're welcome. If you have your Bibles, will you turn with me to 1 Samuel chapter 15? And we're reading from verse 1 to 16. And Samuel said to Saul, "The Lord sent me to anoint you king over his people Israel. Now therefore listen to the words of the Lord. Thus said the Lord of hosts, I have noted that Amalek did to Israel in opposing them on the way when they came up out of Egypt. Now go and strike Amalek and devote to destruction all that they have. Do not spare them, but kill both man and woman, child and infant, ox and sheep, camel and donkey." So Samuel summoned the people and numbered them in Telaim, 200,000 men on foot and 10,000 men of Judah. And Saul came to the city of Amalek and lay in wait in the valley. Then Saul said to the Kenites, "Go, depart, go down from among the Amalekites, lest I destroy you with them. For you showed kindness to all the people of Israel when they came up out of Egypt." So the Kenites departed from among the Amalekites. And Saul defeated the Amalekites from Havilah as far as Shur, which is east of Egypt. And he took Agag, the king of the Amalekites, alive, and devoted to destruction all the people with the edge of the sword. But Saul and the people spared Agag, and the rest of the sheep and of the oxen and of the fattened calves and the lambs and all that was good, and would not utterly destroy them. All that was despised and worthless they devoted to destruction. The word of the Lord came to Samuel, "I regret that I have made Saul king, for he has turned back from following me and has not performed my commandments." And Samuel was angry, and he cried to the Lord all night. And Samuel rose early to meet Saul in the morning. And it was so Samuel. Saul came to Carmel, and behold, he set up a monument for himself and turned and passed on and went down to Gilgal. And Samuel came to Saul, and Saul said to him, "Blessed be you to the Lord. I have performed the commandments of the Lord." And Samuel said, "What then is this bleating of the sheep in my ears and the lowing of the oxen that are here?" Verse 15, Saul said, "They have brought them from the Amalekites, for the people spared the best of the sheep and of the oxen to sacrifice to the Lord your God, and the rest we have devoured to destruction." Then Samuel said to Saul, "Stop, I will tell you what the Lord said to me this night." And he said to him, "Speak." Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your faithfulness, even in watching over your word to perform and perfect it. We thank you for the spoken word this morning. We thank you because you are faithful to us in everything we do. And sometimes we make excuses. We do the wrong thing. We go our own way, but yet you draw us back with your love, strong cord. And this morning, even as we have seen the example of Saul, in disobedience and yet blaming other people, we pray, Lord, that your Holy Spirit will guide us, that we'll always do the right thing, that your Holy Spirit will direct our path, our thought, and everything that we do so that we can bring honor and glory to your name. And as we gather this morning, wherever we may be, we pray, Lord, that your presence will be with us. You say, Lord, that wherever we're gathered in your name, that you'll be right there in our midst. So we thank you for your presence, Holy Spirit. Let everything be done to your glory and to your honor this morning. And we pray, Lord, at the end of the day when we finish our worship, that we'll continue to worship even wherever we find ourselves. We give you praise, Lord, and we give you honor. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thanks for the scripture reading and the prayer. And now it's time to get comfortable, to get up and dance, and let's get ready to worship God in song.
Good morning, Harvest family. We are so happy that you have decided to join us for our online worship as we get ready to lift high the name of Jesus. Ephesians 6 and 12 says, "For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. So if you feel that you are in the heat of the battle right now, I want to remind you that the God we serve is always fighting for us. And in the name of Jesus, we will have the victory. So join us in worship as we sing, God is fighting for us.
Back the darkness.
Says, Lord, you are good. And so right now, we invite you to stay with us for our ministry updates.
We really love connecting with you here at Harvest. And how we do that is that we ask you to complete the connection card. Kindly complete the card, which is found in the link in the comment section. Be sure to include your prayer request. We really love praying for you. And just a gentle reminder, guys, be sure to register for our in-person church next week. Include the service that you wish to attend. We have two services, our 9 a.m. and our 11:15 a.m. What a great honor it is to give to the Lord. And your giving has certainly impacted the lives of many people. If you would like to give, kindly see the account details in the link below. Let's pray. God, we honor you because you are God. Lord, we pray that today in our service that you will be glorified, God, that your presence will hover over the households, offices of the many people that are watching from all over, God. Lord, we pray for those that are very lonely at this time during this pandemic. Lord, remind them that your thoughts are countless, just like the sands on the seashore. Lord, we pray that your spirit will speak to the hearts of those that don't know you as Lord and Savior. And this will be the day that they come to serve you. In Jesus' name, amen.
praise and to lift up the holy name of Jesus. We thank you to be in this sanctuary today, and I pray for each and everyone that has come to this service today. I pray that you bless every heart as we continue to worship you. And also we bring the man of God before you, asking you to guide him, direct him, and bless him, Lord, as he bring the word, Lord. So help us, Lord, to be not only hearers, but also listeners of the word. Guide us and direct us, I pray in Jesus' name.
Hi guys, good day and welcome to Church Online, Harvest Bible Chapel, Turks and Caicos. Thank you so much for tuning in. Our series is Blueprint. It's a study of Matthew chapter 5 all the way to Matthew chapter 7. Today, we're in Matthew chapter 5, verse 21, and we're going to go to verse 26. So I encourage you to open your Bibles and go there right now as you settle in to hear the Word of God. Now, as you're doing that, I want to ask you a question. And though I can't see you, I want you to give me your honest answer. Okay? So full honesty, right? This is the question. How many of you have killed someone? Now remember, honest answer, if you have killed someone, raise your hand. Nobody's going to see you. There are no police officers looking through your window. If you have killed someone, raise your hand. Now, let me go first, and I'll answer, and I'll say this. Yes, I have. So let me ask you again. How many of you have killed someone? Now, hear this. If you are listening to my voice, then your hand should be up because to an extent, we are all murderers. Now, let me clarify quickly. I've never killed someone physically. I've never taken a gun, nor have I ever poisoned someone. I've never shot someone or stabbed someone. And I'm going to say that that is probably the truth for the majority of you listening and watching right now. So, how have we killed others? Let me tell you, by our words and our thoughts. Now, last week, we ended at verse 20, where Jesus told his disciples that if they are to enter into the kingdom of God, their righteousness must be greater than the righteousness of the Pharisees and the teachers of the law. Now, he said this because the Pharisees' righteousness was based on their ability to obey external rules and regulations that they themselves had set up to replace, in many cases, the real intent of the law. But the law was meant to be obeyed from a pure heart through the power of the indwelling Holy Spirit. The righteousness that Jesus demands comes through faith in Jesus, a new heart, and daily walking in surrender to the Holy Spirit. Now, what I'm going to say is very important, so listen up, right? For the Christian, our actions are very important. But get this, the motive behind our actions are even more important. Now look at what Jesus says in Matthew 15, 18. What comes out of the mouth proceeds from the heart, and this defiles a person. For out of the heart come evil thoughts, murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false witness, slander. These are what defile a person. What this text is telling us, that it's your motive stemming from your heart that actually defiles you. And at the same time, when God looks at you, he looks at your actions, but he also looks at your heart, and he sees your heart, and he will judge your heart. So loved one, it's about your heart. Now, when we look at people, we see their actions. When Jesus looks at people, he sees their heart, and he bases righteousness, right? That's the basis that he uses for true righteousness, because it's from the heart that our actions flow. It's from the heart that our words flow. It's from the heart, in a sense, that our thoughts flow. So if you have a bad, ugly heart. You may be able to fool some people by pretending to be nice, by pretending to be what you're not. But you cannot fool God. And it is Him you will stand before and give account for the state of your heart. Now, I don't know your heart, obviously, but you do. And Jesus certainly does. Because He sees in every dark, deep crevice of your heart. So I want you to answer this question honestly. Is your heart right before God? Is your heart pure before God? And another question similar to the first two is this: are your motives pure? No, I pray it is. I pray that you could answer and say, without a shadow of a doubt, my heart is in a good place. But if it is not, I want to encourage you and beg you and challenge you to make it right. Go before God, confess to Him, God, I have a bad heart, I have a sinful heart. Would you please take it and give me a new one? And when you do that, God is going to answer you and He's going to give you a new heart. And it is from that new heart that you are going to obey all the things that God is calling you to do through Jesus Christ and the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. Okay, let's look at the text now, because Jesus is about to challenge His disciples who He was speaking to, and He's about to challenge us about the condition of our heart. And I want you to realize, and I pray, because we prayed before this service started, before this sermon started, that the words that are spoken here, the teaching that is going to come forth, that it will challenge you in a deep and meaningful way. But not just challenge you, but it will challenge you so that you can change into being the person that God wants you to be. So look at the text, verse 21. You have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not murder, and whoever murders will be liable to judgment. But I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother will be liable to judgment. Whoever insults his brother will be liable to the council, and whoever says, you fool, will be liable to the hell of fire. So if you're offering your gift at the altar, and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First be reconciled to your brother, and then come and offer your gift. Come to terms quickly with your accuser while you're going with him to court, lest your accuser hand you over to the judge, and the judge to the guard, and you be put in prison. Truly, I say to you, you will never get out until you have paid the last penny. Now, notice this, right? And I want you to note this because we spent a lot of time last week sort of setting the foundation for what was going to come after. And I want us to know that what Jesus is teaching, and we have to know the foundation. Jesus is not contradicting the Old Testament laws. As we said last week, He didn't come to abolish it, but He came to fulfill it. He came to realize it. He came to complete it. So when Jesus said what He said here, in fact, He was upholding and fulfilling it, even though it may look at first reading like if He's contradicting it. But in reality, He's contradicting the teachers of the law who had added and took away from the law and then taught others what was false. Now, when Jesus quotes the Old Testament, He would often say, it is written. But here, He's not quoting the Old Testament, but He's addressing the misrepresentation of the sixth commandment by the false teachers who started by cutting the law and adding different pieces. He's speaking to them. They had corrupted the laws of God, and Jesus is addressing them when He says, but you have heard it said of old, but I say no. He's bringing the real intention or the real meaning of the law back to those that He is speaking to. So write this down right now. Let it go. Yep, write it down. Let it go. Because sin starts on the inside with a thought, if you detect anger in your heart towards a brother or sister in the faith, I want to say this to you, let it go. Paul says in Ephesians 4:26, be angry and sin not. So let me be quick to say this. There is a righteous anger that erupts in us when we see wrong or we see evil. When Jesus saw what the worship of God had become, he was righteously angry. And what did he do? He went into the temple and he took action. He turned over the tables and he was angry because they had corrupted the true worship of God. Now, if you are driving on the highway and you see a man or a group of men beating a woman or beating a child, and then in your spirit, a righteous anger cries out, no! And you stop and you seek to defend that person who's been beaten or abused, that is righteous anger. Jesus is not referring to that righteous anger here in this passage. Let me say this. Anger is a temptation to sin, and if left unchecked, it will lead to destructive actions. Now, 5 verses later, after Paul says, be angry and sin not, he then says this, let all bitterness, let all wrath, and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you along with all malice. So the anger that Jesus is talking about here is not the righteous anger that erupts when we see evil and spurs us on to action, but it is the anger that is a sort of smoldering kind of anger. It's the anger that a person nurtures and keeps alive for days and weeks and months. It's a hateful anger. Now, though the object of the anger may not know it, God does. And he says that this anger, this smoldering, nurtured, deep down anger that you hold in your heart for someone else, that anger leads to divine judgment. And because this anger leads to divine judgment from God, loved one, I want to say this to you, let it go. If you have a deep-seated anger in your heart towards somebody, a brother or sister in the faith, probably even a family member, and you name the name of Christ, let it go. Because if you hold on to that anger, it is going to lead to destructive actions on your part, but even more so, it is going to lead to divine judgment. Now, here are a few ways in which you can let go of anger. Here's the first one. Whatever the offense that was done against you, let me encourage you from Scripture to do this. Overlook it. Proverbs 19:11 says, good sense makes one slow to anger, and it is his glory to overlook an offense. That means, to overlook an offense means take no notice of the wrong done to you. It means that you refuse to dwell on and think deeply about what was done to you. It means you refuse to nurture that seed of anger until it grows into a tree. It means that you refuse to retaliate. It means that you refuse to seek revenge. So the man or the woman who does this, overlooking an offense, what they're doing is that by their actions, they're showing spiritual maturity. They're exercising spiritual grace. The text says it is his glory to do so. It is his glory to overlook an offense, meaning it shows everyone. When you overlook an offense, it shows everyone that the Holy Spirit is present in your life, that the Holy Spirit is working and it's active in your life, and that you are obeying Scripture. You are walking in maturity, the Spirit's glory, when you overlook an offense, be it large or be it big. So let go of the anger towards a brother or sister in the faith by overlooking it. Secondly, this is how you let go of anger. Talk about it. Talk about it. Go to the person and say, hey, listen, this thing is bugging me, and I want to talk to you about it. What's the textual reference? Well, James 1:19 says this. Know this, my beloved brothers. Let every person be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger. For the anger of man does not produce the righteousness of God. So we see the danger in anger. But oftentimes when we are angry, we do the opposite of what James says here. We are slow to listen, quick to speak, and at the same time, quick to get angry. What is being advocated here is go to the person and talk to them and be willing to listen. Go to the person that you are angry with and listen to them. Hear them out. Hear their side of the story. And as you do, speak less, listen more, the anger that was nurtured in your heart, which may have been the result of you not knowing the entire picture, that anger will dissipate as you listen to your brother or sister share their side of the story. So let go of your anger by going to the person that you're angry with, talking to them, letting them know, and then saying, I want to hear your side of the story. So listen more. Here's the third thing. The first two, overlook the offense, talk to the person, and the third one is this, love them. Love them. Proverbs 17:9 says, whoever covers an offense seeks love, but he who repeats a matter separates close friends. And in the same breath, Proverbs chapter 10, verse 12 says, love covers all wrongs. And of course, I'm sure you're very familiar with 1 Corinthians chapter 12. The one who loves does so because he has been loved by his Father in heaven. And in love, he goes and he covers his brother or sister's faults or offense under the blanket of love. Kingdom relationships should be an example for others to emulate. We should be telling those outside of the kingdom of God, listen, this is how we deal with issues. This is how we deal with offenses. When we get angry at a brother, or when we get angry at a sister, this is what we do in the kingdom. We let it go. We let it go. We overlook the offense. We go to them and we talk to them and we listen to them. And then we cover their faults, so to speak, under a blanket of love, because love overlooks an offense. Kingdom relationships should reflect the relationship of the Godhead. That's our standard. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, mutually coexisting, communicating with one another, loving one another. Our relationships in the kingdom of God should reflect that relationship. That's our standard, and that should be our practice. So, first thing to stop the killing is to let it go. The second is this. Speak life. Speak life. A murderous heart harbors anger towards a brother or sister in the faith. A murderous heart also belittles and insults a brother or sister in the faith through their words. Now, remember this text from earlier, Matthew 15:18. What comes out of the mouth proceeds from the heart. And this is what defiles a person. For out of the heart come evil thoughts, murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false witness, slander. These are what defile a person. In other words, a wicked heart speaks evil of others, cursing and maligning them. Now, the word raka was an expression that meant empty-headed. So to call a person raka, right, was to really and truly call them a dimwit, a numbskull. It was to question their intelligence. And then to call someone a fool, in the sense that Jesus was using it here, was to label someone as morally corrupt and worthless. Now, notice the progression. The murderer's heart first has anger, and then that anger, when it's nurtured, it breeds hurtful words. It breeds a desire to question a person's intelligence, question their morality, right? Right? That is what a murderer's heart does. Now, when you put this together, a heart with anger and a mouth that's spouting evil, when you put them together, it is an expression of a sinful, deep-seated hatred towards a fellow believer made in the image of God and redeemed by the death of Jesus Christ on the cross and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's what we do when we nurture anger and we begin to belittle others with our words. Look at what 1 John chapter 3 and verse 15 says. Everyone who hates his brother is a murderer. And you know that no murderer has eternal life abiding in him. That's a powerful word there. No murderer has eternal life abiding in him. Anger that leads to hatred is not consistent with a man or a woman living in the kingdom of God. So anger left unchecked breeds hatred. Hatred spawns murder, and murder is a wanton disregard for another person's life. And if you still think harboring ill will in your heart towards another person is nothing because you aren't quote-unquote hurting them, look at the progression of the repercussions of having a murderous heart. Starts with judgment, and then the council, and then hellfire. Anger and insulting words against a fellow believer attracts God's anger. Look at another text of to really expand on that thought. It's Matthew chapter 12 from verse 34. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So your words reflect the condition of your heart. So you know, people often say, oh, that slipped out. Oh, I didn't mean to say that. Yes, you did, in a sense. It was in your heart. And what's in your heart will eventually come out through your mouth. So if you have been harboring anger in your heart towards a brother, then you will speak words of death over them. But the text goes on. The good person out of the good treasure brings forth good, meaning good words here. And the evil person out of his evil treasure brings forth evil. Now I tell you, on the day of judgment, people will give account for every careless word they speak. For by your words you will be justified, and by your words, you will be condemned. So God is saying, listen, at the day of judgment, those things you said about your brother or sister in the faith that came from an angry heart, those things will be judged. And God is recording every single word that is spoken against a fellow believer, especially if it comes from a murderer's evil heart. As believers, our words carry great weight. So when we choose to criticize, when we choose to speak words of defeat, hopelessness, death over another person, or when we decide to spread lies and slander about them, we are killing them. We are killing them. And it may not be physically at first. It will start with their character and their reputation, but eventually it will get there. We are character assassinating people when we speak evil words about them, when we speak death over them. So what should we do? Well, as believers, Ephesians 4:29 and Colossians 4:6 put together says that we should use our words to build others up and to speak life over them. Now, speaking life means to give encouragement. It means to offer hope and support. It means to express love and kindness. It means to bless and not curse. And yes, they may have hurt you. And yes, they may have caused you pain. And yes, they may have offended you. But do what Jesus commands. Bless those who curse you. Speak life over them. So do this week. Go to someone and speak life over them. Go to someone, yes, this week, today, if possible. The day that you listen to this, go to someone and speak life over them. Praise them for something that they have done well. Thank them for something that they have done that was a blessing to you or others. Validate a special talent or a special gift that they have. Honor them and encourage them to continue doing good and continue doing right. Parents, I need you to hear this. Pay special attention because your child or children, they are craving your words of life. They are craving life-giving words from your mouth over their lives. Hearing that they are stupid or they're worthless or they will never amount to anything is killing them. What they want to hear, what they need to hear, parents, is you speaking life over them, encouraging their efforts, validating their gifts, honoring them, blessing them, speaking a good prophetic word over them. So parents, speak life over your children. No, I know what you're going to say. Oh, Pastor, you don't know my children. You don't know my children. Speak life over them and they will change. Speak life over them and they will become the children that you are proud of. And then again, they're your children. So what does that say about who you are? But parents, please speak life over them, especially during a season like this. Speak life over your children. Husbands, speak life over your wife. She craves it. She needs it. And wives, in the same breath, your husbands, they need you to speak life over them. Not cursings, not anger, not belittling them, not seeking to emasculate them, but speaking life over them and blessing them and thanking God for them and thanking them for their work and their effort. And I want to circle back and say this, husbands. Speak life over your wife. She isn't perfect and neither are you. So speak life. Because the children that you want and the marriage that you want and the superstar wife that you want, when you speak life over them, you're going to get that. Speaking death and cursings and defeat will never bring about anything good. Parents, husbands, wives, speak life over each other. Believers, let me come to you now. Speak life over those who teach and preach the word of God to you. Speak life over your church, your local assembly. Now, let me say this. I have been in Christian leadership for close to 19 years now. I've served in various positions, and I could say this. The volume of death and defeat that believers speak over their leaders and churches is simply astounding. Believers who daily go to church speak words of death over their teachers and leaders and pastors. Speak words of death over their churches. Now, let me say this, right? If you are speaking death over another man's bride, because that is what you do when you speak over the church, because the church is the bride of Jesus. When you do that, you're speaking against God himself. Think about that. Now, this is what God says. Based on 1 Samuel chapter 8, verse 7. When you speak ill against the church, unwarranted, when you speak ill against its leaders and its members, unwarranted, based on 1 Samuel 8:7, you're speaking against God. You're speaking evil of God himself. You touch the church, you touch God. You touch the apple of his eye, and God will deal with you. So take note. Stop speaking death over your church. It's not perfect, and again, neither are you. No church is perfect. Stop speaking death over your pastor. Speak life over them. And then they may get better, so to speak. Now, I want to say this. If you are a church leader, I want to encourage you. The attacks that are coming against you verbally, it's not against you. They are attacking God. They're speaking ill of God. Let God fight for you, church leader. You keep silent. You keep praying. You keep walking in humility. And let God fight for you. Let God deliver you. Let God vindicate you. Let God defend your cause. You keep silent, church leader. Keep silent. Now, to those who are using their words for tearing down God's people, they're using their words to tear down God's servant. I want you to be warned, but I'm only warning you because I want you to change. God's judgment will be against you if you are using words like that. Look at this text. The one I just read before. That divine judgment awaits the person or persons who speak evil. Who speak evil, and especially if it is against God's people. So my warning, I pray that it will be a loving rebuke that you can begin, instead of speaking death, you can speak life over all those in your home, at your workplace, in your place of worship. Speak life. Speak life, loved ones. Speak life. Speak life. And when you speak life, you would see life. Now look at the text, verse 23, Matthew 5, verse 23. So if you are offering your gift at the altar, and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First, be reconciled to your brother, and then come and offer your gift. Come to terms quickly with your accuser while you are going with him to court, lest your accuser hand you over to the judge and the judge to the guard and you be put in prison. Truly I say to you, you will never get out until you have paid the last penny. So write this down. Seek reconciliation. To stop the killing, with our words and our thoughts, we must let go of anger, we must speak life, and thirdly, we need to seek reconciliation. We need to prioritize reconciliation. And reconciliation is important because it is so important that Jesus says in the parable here that he was telling that you should interrupt your worship to do so. And you know why you should interrupt your worship? Because if you have not been reconciled to a brother or sister, then your worship is going to be affected. Unresolved conflict in your heart is going to affect your worship to God. Remember, God sees your heart. He judges it. So stop what you're doing and restore right worship with God by restoring a right relationship with your brother or sister. Now, who should take the first step? I could just hear somebody say, okay, yes, I'll seek reconciliation, but who should take the first step? Let me tell you, from the text here that I just read, the guilty party, the one who have sinned against a brother or sister, that person should take the initiative and seek reconciliation in order to restore the relationship. A few weeks ago, I preached from Matthew 18. And Matthew 18 says that the one who was offended should take the initiative to reconcile the relationship. So which is right? Here's the answer. Both of them are. Reconciliation is so important that both parties, the offending one and the offended, should take steps to make it right. So if you're in your living room and you're like, well, I'm not going to her and I'm not going to him because she did this and she did that, Scripture says, take the first step. If you have been offended, take the first step. Send a message, send an email, get an intermediary, get a mediator, but take the first step. And if you're in your living room and you're like, well, they deserve what they got, Scripture says you need to take the first step. And you see what happens, loved one? When both the offended and the offender come together, reconciliation is possible. But here's the other thing about reconciliation. You need to do it right away. Because animosity could be like a ticking time bomb that if left alone, it blows up and it causes untold damage. Now, I believe that there are many relationships within the body of Christ that could have been mended if the parties, both parties, had moved right away to fix it. If they moved right away to fix it, that relationship would have been mended. If you're thinking, I ain't going, Pastor, you could talk all you want. You could talk till you blue in the face. I ain't moving. Let me tell you this, and I say this out of love. Not seeking reconciliation leads to divine judgment. It leads to judgment. There's a penalty to pay if you don't seek reconciliation. It may not be hell, but it may be the loss of heavenly rewards at the end of time when you stand before God. No, there's a law of sowing and reaping. Here's what Galatians chapter 6, verse 7 says. Do not be deceived, God is not mocked. For whatever one sows, that will he also reap. For the one who sows to his own flesh will from the flesh reap corruption. But the one who sows to the Spirit will from the Spirit reap eternal life. And then it goes on in verse 9, it says, let us not grow weary of doing good, for in due season we will reap if we do not give up. So as we have the opportunity, let us do good to everyone, especially to those of the household of faith. What is this text speaking about? Well, it is pointing out a principle of sowing and reaping. This sowing and reaping principle goes like this. If you sow animosity, if you sow conflict, if you sow dissension, if you sow divisiveness, if you sow discord among brothers, then you are going to reap that. You are going to reap it. But if you sow unity and peace and reconciliation, if you sow words that are calm and peaceful, then you are going to reap that at the day of judgment. Now, sowing and reaping leads to judgment because one day we're going to stand before the bema seat of Christ, as mentioned in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 10, which says this: we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ so that each one may receive what is due for what he has done in the flesh, whether good or evil. So when you choose to harden your heart and not seek reconciliation with your brother, you are jeopardizing your heavenly reward. And I believe that is why there will be tears in heaven when there are men and women who have sowed to the flesh and they have sowed conflict and animosity, and they stand before God and there is no reward, because God is saying, this is what you did. And you are reaping now what you sowed then. Sow peace, loved ones. Sow reconciliation. Stop the killing of a brother or sister by words. If there's anger in your heart against someone, let it go. Begin to speak life over others. Even if they have hurt you, speak life over them. Even though you have fallen out with them, speak life over them. If you have been offended by them, speak life over them. And then do everything in your power to seek godly reconciliation. If you do that, based on the principle of sowing and reaping in Galatians 6, and based on the fact that we are going to stand and we have to give an account to God in 2 Corinthians 5, as it says there, you will reap an eternal reward of righteousness and good things. But do the opposite, and you are going to suffer the consequences. Loved ones, stop the killing. Stop the killing. There's a genocide that is taking place in our time. Not guns and bombs, but words and thoughts. Do your part and stop the killing. Let go of your anger. Speak life. Seek reconciliation. Let us pray. Father, thank you so much for your word. I pray that this word will hit home. I pray that it hits my heart. Do a work in my heart. And I pray that everyone who is listening, that this word will hit home by the power of your spirit. Lead your people to pursue kingdom relationships, to love brothers and sisters, and to do good, not evil. So, Father, take this word. Use it to convince, to convict, or to give confidence to your people. In Jesus' name, amen.
Wow, what a profound message by Pastor Kenyatta. I'm sure you were blessed. I was. If you've made the decision to make Jesus Lord and Savior over your life, you may contact us here on Facebook or by using the number that's on the screen. Remember to pay special attention to the application questions. Also, remember to like, subscribe, and share. Finally, you are loved.